First of all, good morning to all, and I would like to first say that I'm very, very, very overwhelmed that Renee is moderating this session. I know that she had a very grave tragedy, so salute to Renee for so much dedication to work, which is worth emulating. I would also like to really thank the Academy for giving this opportunity to talk about rare genetic diseases in the annual meeting. So I think it's a reflection that the time is now right for us to address these diseases, because so far they were sort of in the background, but now with the advent of technologies which are allowing us to detect mutations at a much more reasonable cost, affordable by patients, and also the possibility that gene introduction can be done to correct the mutation, or gene editing can be done. So with the advent of these technologies, now the time looks like ripe to address these diseases and give hope to the patients who so far were always told that there's no treatment for them. So we have a lineup of four very eminent speakers who will talk to us about various issues related to genetic diseases. But before we go into the meat of the topic, I thought I'll just give some introductory remarks, because this is for the whole academy, and there will be some fellows and associates who are not very familiar with this area. So I'll just give some introduction. Now, genetic diseases, they are caused by changes in the genetic material, as the very term signifies. And this could be an entire chromosome, or it could be a point mutation in a single gene. So these diseases, they are different from infectious disease, for example, because like infection is caused by an external agent. And so if you have appropriate control measures, you can even eradicate these external agents and then get rid of the disease. But unlike this, the genetic disease actually within us, within our genome, and new mutations keep arising by mechanisms which are inbuilt into our biology. And so we live with these diseases. And these diseases are actually very secular, as we can see from history that they touch one and all. And even the royal families, like the ancient house of Egypt to Queen Victoria's descendants, they have been affected by recorded genetic diseases, and they have even changed the course of history. Now, these diseases so far have not been addressed to the extent that one would have liked by the clinical establishment. And there are reasons, because there are a lot of complexities associated with them which have been hard to address. For example, we can see that mutations in different genes can actually lead to a very, very similar clinical presentation. So that makes it very difficult for the clinician to pinpoint the correct diagnosis so far. The opposite also happens, that you can have the same gene, depending on where the mutation is located, you can have very, very different disease outcomes. So again, it adds to the level of complexity, which is puzzling. Then we find that there are siblings in the same family with the same exact mutation, but they present with different disease severity, because there could be modifying effects of other genes, or there could be factors like the environment or nutrition or lifestyle. So that also impinges on the basic genetic mutation. So far, that's for these reasons. For the doctor, it was quite difficult to accurately diagnose such diseases. But as I said, that with the advent of technology, especially next generation sequencing, and the cost of technology, the cost of getting diagnosis done at the nucleotide level coming down rapidly, and the new technologies which we will hear in this session today are making it much better to get very accurate diagnosis for every patient. And that is the first thing that we need, an accurate diagnosis. So with that possibility in hand, at least this complexity will be removed. So also because treatments are not available, so the clinical interest becomes small because the patient really is not helped by the doctor. The doctor has nothing much to offer. But this scenario again is also rapidly changing. Now, genetic diseases obviously have a very huge translational potential, and that is, provides a very good challenge to scientists to work on. But I would like to emphasize here that not only translation, but they also contribute to basic science, to our knowledge about how our bodies work. And this has been seen in history, like in the 1930s when phenylketonuria, an inborn error of metabolism, was first discovered. It actually was a time when people were also doing, the field of biochemistry was opening up. And phenylketonuria is caused by a defect in the enzyme phenylalanine hydroxylase. And it leads to phenylalanine, which is an amino acid, it starts accumulating in the blood and it becomes toxic. So when this was analyzed by doctors and by biochemists, then it became clear that actually an amino acid like phenylalanine and all other metabolites in the body are linked to each other through pathways. So they are synthesized, they are metabolized, and they give rise to a precursor-product relationship. So these metabolic pathways actually became clear through the study of such diseases. Another disease which really remarkably moved the field of molecular biology at that time was sickle cell anemia, where a single point mutation in the beta globin gene, it leads to a change in an amino acid. And Linus Pauling, who was a very, very great protein chemist, he had shown that the structure of beta globin from patients in sickle cell anemia was different from normal hemoglobin. And then that could be traced to a change at the nucleotide level. So that lent support to the genetic code and started the whole field of molecular medicine. So then I would like to point out that because genetic diseases have not been studied to the extent that other diseases have been, so therefore sometimes the clinician out of exasperation just can't do much about it. And the field has actually been pushed by patients themselves. So if you look at the history of phenylketonuria, the field was pushed by two mothers who were separated almost two decades apart. The first mother in the 1930s was desperately looking for doctors who can tell her what is happening to her little child who is getting slowly mentally retarded. And then she came upon a doctor who was a chemist actually to begin with. And because he was a chemist, he analyzed the urine of the baby and he found that there was an accumulation of phenylpyruvate in the urine. And that led to the diagnosis that it was due to phenylalanine accumulation in the blood. But then it did not lead to any treatment. That was left to another mother who then changed another doctor in a different country. And that led to the first protein formula for phenylketonuria, where phenylalanine levels were less in that diet, but there was adequate protein supplementation. And that led to the first medical food, which now is helping so many little babies. So this was a beginning where we found that these mothers were in total isolation just by the determination of pushing it. Now we find that actually their patient groups were working together and they are even getting funding, collecting funds to fund research. And the parent project Muscular Dystrophy in 2016 could manage to reverse the FDA decision and they could get approval for exon skipping drug for their children. So we also have opened one such effort, World Without GNE Myopathy, where we are bringing together patients and doctors and scientists because we feel that patients really have a role to play to push the research to find treatments for genetic diseases. So lastly, I would just like to say that Whenever we talk about genetic diseases, the adjective rare is always there, but actually these diseases are not so rare. So genetic defects are actually found in almost 10% of all adults, even though they may be minor and they may not manifest as clinical symptoms. So about 6,000 different genetic diseases are already known, and there may be more which we don't know about yet. However, the total number of patients in any particular disease is small, and that's why they are considered to be rare. But in fact, rare is the family that is entirely free of a genetic disorder. So I'll end here. Thank you.